Happy New Year, Missketeers! Welcome back to Missing Out Mondays, where we tell you what we're into. Start your week off right. I'm Tauri Jay.
I am Lex Michael.
Lex Michael? Oh my gosh, it's a new year. What are you into now?
So one of the nifty little things I got for myself over Christmas, because I was in a Star Warsy mood, as many of us were, for $10. Like I didn't realize that this was even an option, and I'm very excited that I stumbled upon this. So are you familiar with J.W. Rinzler's making of Star Wars books?
No.
Okay, so they are essentially they're at this point considered the like quintessential, the ultimate, the making of Star Wars books to own, to read. Like they are the definitive histories.
Okay.
He worked for Lucasfilm, and he was working on the Episode 3 making of book. And around that time, he got access to these archived interviews that had never been released, that I believe were compiled in preparation for another making of book that never saw the light of day. And These are all interviews that are taken from the production of Star Wars, but we're talking like from 75 to about 78. So you've got like from early stages of this movie coming to be through production to release to shortly after release, where in 78 it had come out and was a big success, but you know, Empire Strikes Back was 2 years away. Nobody could have known at the time what Star Wars would become, you know? And so it's a very candid, very in the moment, very, you know, it's not present day interviews where people are looking back on a movie they made 40 years ago, knowing now that it's one of the biggest things in pop culture history.
Right.
It's all very, very immediate and very real. And again, interviews that have never, before the release of this book, had never been released anywhere. Now, what they did more recently was they took the entire book and all of the media associated with the book and put together this really cool deluxe, they call it an enhanced edition of the book for ebook, for, you know, for your computer, for tablets, for phones. And whereas the hardcover, the physical hardcover of this thing is about $75 last time I checked, The enhanced ebook, $10.
Okay.
$10. All right. So I saw that this was available. I'm like, hell yes, I'm going to drop $10 on this. I don't know what enhanced means, but sweet. I've been wanting to read this book for a long time, and I haven't had the $75 lying around to buy a physical copy.
Yeah.
So I paid for it. I loaded it up onto my iPad. This thing is crazy cool. So you read it in landscape mode, and when you come to media, for example, in the book, say you see a picture, you can swipe through on the picture like it's Instagram, and you can see other pictures that are pertinent, that are part of the same little gallery. You can blow these pictures up, and you can, you know, look at them in far greater detail. But they also have audio and video embedded into the book. So for example, they talk about sort of the genesis of the idea of Star Wars. Like George Lucas was a big fan of the old Flash Gordon serials, for example.
Yeah.
And him, they include an interview piece, like audio of an interview where he talks about that and about wanting to sort of replicate that same feeling that he got watching the Flash Gordon serials for another generation of kids. You've got, you know, then video that's embedded in the book, you know, that you can sort of hit play on and watch as you go through. And I think I so desperately want them to do all of his making of books this way. He did one for Planet of the Apes. He did the original, the entire Star Wars trilogy this way. And they're all now available in the enhanced ebook edition.
Okay.
But he did one for the original Planet of the Apes. He did one book that covers all 4 Indiana Jones movies. More recently, he did one on Alien, which came out that I want to check out. That's apparently fantastic. And he's got one coming out on Aliens this year, I think just in a couple of months as of this recording. But if you are a fan and you haven't, like I had not checked out Rinzler Star Wars books before, I highly recommend doing it this way for 2 reasons. One, obviously the price is drastically lower buying the ebook version, but also because you get this additional experience. You get this video content. You get the interactivity of the way the pictures are laid out. You get a whole lot that you can't necessarily experience with the physical version of the book. So I just started reading it. I'm having a ton of fun with it. And getting to learn more little detailed minutiae, granular bits of information on the making of one of the most widely known, beloved, influential movies of all time, a movie I grew up with just as a film nerd, that stuff like really does it for me. So I definitely recommend it. J.W. Rinzler's making of Star Wars.
Awesome. That sounds really cool. I like that the enhanced version wasn't just like, it's enhanced because it's digital. That seems like a really great experience.
They did something really, really cool with it. And I like to think if we're all still here in the future and we're still allowed to have schools and things, that textbooks can sort of be laid out the same way. You know what I mean? Like, that's a great way to sort of implement this same type of formatting.
Right. I mean, that's kind of what podcasts do nowadays. You know what I'm saying? You go on, you do that 27 greatest album thing that we did a while ago. Interactive, baby. It's got videos. It's got pictures. It's got interviews. It's so good. Anyways, I'm going to talk about my thing this time.
Yeah, what's your thing?
All right. So on New Year's Eve, a colleague of mine back when I was working at Awesomeness, he started hosting a show on Netflix called Sugar Rush.
Okay.
And it has a, it's basically the, one of the, a successor or a sister show to Nailed It, which everyone loves. Everyone's a big fan of, Nicole Byer. It's a fun show.
I've not seen, but I hear people like it.
Yeah. It's fun. It celebrates failure in a way that I think, not enough shows do. But Sugar Rush is kind of the opposite in that instead of bringing in amateur, bakers, they actually bring in professional bakers. And the idea or the premise is that they have a certain amount of time to make these dishes. And so the first two rounds, they have 3 hours to make one, a cupcake, and then a confection. And so the faster they finish their cupcakes, the earlier they can get started on their confection, and the more time they have left over in that 3 hours, it goes towards the cake round.
Okay.
And so they bring in a really fun group of like diverse individuals. People have a lot of different backgrounds. Some of these people make amazing confections and cupcakes. Some people are like, oh man, we are cupcake people, but we're not cake people, or we're cake people and we never make confections. So they're like trying all these things on the fly, which is really cool. Sometimes people are just so fucking good at what they're doing,
right,
that like you just want to eat everything that they're making. They're like, yeah, you know, I used science, because baking is in fact like, it's food science. It's all food science, guys. Like, you have no fucking idea how much food science it goes into baking. But like, a lot of people are very adept at it, and so like, there's also the challenge of the aesthetics of it as well. And so then the more you watch it, the more you start to realize like, all right, there's not just the challenge of making it taste good, but also the presentation of it. And so some people get really into the aesthetics and they forget to make it stand out with some kind of taste. Or some people get really deep into the taste and then they present it in a plain fashion. Or some people, amateurs, they're like, we're going to make two cupcakes. And you're like, guys, you ain't got time for that. This is a timed show. It's called Sugar Rush. And so like, just watching people go through these pieces and like figure out the steps and what they want to bring in to their confections and their cakes. I love the people who are like, this is my grandma's recipe for cake. And then it like pays off. For people who are like, I'm going to make a big swing. I'm going to do this really cool, thing that I've never done before, but like I've heard about, and now I have the tools to do it, so I'm gonna do it, and it like pays off so good. There's an episode where they're supposed to make a confection that looks like something else, and so these two girls decided to make what looks like avocado toast, but it's all like different stuff. And so for the egg, they used a little mousse, and they did it this like, I forget what the name of the technique was, but it basically made the mousse seem like runny egg. Like when you cut into it, it ran like an egg yolk.
Okay.
It's phenomenal.
That's impressive.
So I highly recommend it. It's on Netflix. Hunter March is the host, who is the person I used to work with, and he's a good host. Judges are really fun. Adriano, who's like the pastry king in Australia, and then the
owner of Sprinkles, or the founder of Sprinkles, is also one of the judges.
All right.
And then they have like rotating guest judges. So it's great. I highly recommend it. If you're just like, I want something to watch in the background, or you're super invested in cooking shows,
right,
this is great. This will always give you someone to root for.
Yeah, I'm very fascinated with this big wave of baking shows in particular that seems to have emerged in the past several years, but it seems to be bringing a lot of people a lot of joy.
Yeah, I mean, I think that like baking shows have always been a big thing, especially if you had like Food Network, but as streaming platforms and different shows or different like platforms continue to grow, like baking shows are easy to produce. You can do them very quickly. You can do them very cheaply, and all you need is someone to book and a place for them to like exist,
right,
and fun personalities. And so like, I think it's easy content to make that people can really invest in. So that's what I'm into. What about y'all at home? What have you gotten into over the last holiday season? What are you into this new year? Let us know on Twitter at Missing Outcast, MissingOutcast. But also, if you're like, fuck Tauri, I don't want to talk to him, then you can talk to Lex. You can do so on Twitter or Instagram. Where's that?
At the Lex Michael. But I would be like, that guy's my friend. That's rude.
Nah, it's cool. I mean, if you don't like me, you can tell me to my face at Tauri Jay. T-U-R-I-J-A-Y. But you gotta follow me first. Follow me and then tell me to my face. Tomorrow, make sure to tune in for our main show. We're gonna be talking about John Carpenter's 1988, They Live.
It's a very 2020 movie.
Oh yeah. Because you gotta see good in it. We'll figure it out. We'll like
tune in tomorrow to see if we crack the glaringly obvious 2020 vision show. See, we left him on a cliffhanger.
Oh yeah, that's how you gotta do it. Oh man, we hope to hear from you guys, and also Happy New Year once again. We will talk to you tomorrow. Bye.
That was good. That was very good. We're back. Look at this. We're back. I wasn't prepared.
It seems like it. Get it together.